I am Dr. Uday Chatterjee, assistant professor of geography, Bhattra College, Daton. On this official Facebook page of Bhattra College, Daton, I like to introduce Dr. Akhilendranath Tiwari. He is an assistant professor of geography, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel College, VR. He is also an former assistant professor of associate professor of geography, Yobe State University, Nigeria. So, on behalf of Bhattra College and on behalf of geography department, Bhattra College, Daton, we welcome you, sir. And I like to request you to start the session. Your topic is cosmography to scientific geography, transition from cosmography to scientific geography. I think your lecture will be enrich our student, our faculty member, and we also thank you to coming on this Facebook platform. So I like to request you, please start your session, sir.
Am I live now?
Yes, sir.
Am I live now?
Yes, sir, you are live.
Good morning to all of you. Thank you, Dr. Uday Chatterjee and all the staff of Daton College for providing me this opportunity to communicate with you and give a lecture on transition from cosmography to scientific geography. This is a topic in your CBCS system, master system, one semester. I think it is semester four or so. So, as Dr. Uday Chatterjee requested me, and I took up the challenge to let us come forward in this COVID-19 pandemic and take our academics to the level where we can all communicate. And that is the essence of cosmography. In fact, we can say that we started from the very old Greek period of geography, the concept of geography when it started, and it was termed by Eratosthenes as geo plus graphis, that is the earth and its equipes, its description, to the Middle Ages of cosmography, and from there to scientific geography. So what we really mean here, that post-Renaissance, that is around 15th to 16th century onwards, the term cosmography was used a lot. It had both type of, like, astronomical information, then description of different parts of the earth surface, then the messages and data collected through poets and literate scholars on different parts of the world. They were all called as cosmography. But actually, it was like we had some concepts. We have some concepts where our mental images lead to theoretical annihilation, and then percepts, where the direct observation were written into reality, and all these things were basically descriptive. So what we will do here, we will have some little bit of chronological discussion, how this concept came up. But the main essence of cosmography is where we live, the space or the place where we live. That today, if I say how a space is defined, if you say it as a absolute mode, you will have latitude, longitude, and altitude. Today's time, but earlier time when the concept started, let's say from the times of Hecatus to Eratosthenes, when they had some nascent stages of different climatic zones and all, to the Roman phase when Strabo, who gave the concept of acumen, a habitat where people settled, or to the time of Ptolemy. Why I'm saying Strabo, because he was probably the first, we can say, geographer who had almost 17 volumes of work related to whole regional description of the different places of the earth. Then comes Ptolemy, who said that geography is a sublime science that sees the reflection of the earth in human. He also had written Guide to Geography. It was in 8 volumes. And from there, we have a lot of things, and all these things were discussed in geography. But the time came for the age of explorations post-Renaissance, when Columbus went for searching new world, or Vasco da Gama came to India, and Peter Apian, who prepared a earlier heart-shaped map of the earth with both latitude, longitude, or Cramer, who created Mercator's projection. In Mercator's projection, how the whole of Earth's surface on a single network of latitude and longitude was shown, and the universally acceptable routes to move to different parts of the world were found. And at the same time, there was a parallel, almost 16th century, there was a parallel movement going on when Nicolaus Copernicus found the heliocentric concept, and it was later refined by Kepler, then further refined by Galileo. And we know how he tried to find out the mathematical order of the universe. Then 1656, when Newton found the law of gravitation. So a lot of things were going on in the discovery of physical sciences. And at the same time, Magellan, he also moved a lot north and west. And even we have the name Magellan Strait and all. Then Captain Cook and his voyage. Before that, let us come to the first real work on cosmography, the term that we have started. It was given by Sebastian Münster, a German who wrote a 6-volume book, Cosmographie Universalis. It was a combination of tradition and science, and almost he had a team of 120 people. And first volume of his book, actually he concentrated on what Ptolemy has done for the general picture of the earth, and the rest 5 volumes he have described major division of the earth's surface. And it was, you can say, the first real work on the field of cosmography. Almost for next 100 years, I think that was the only book which was the reference material for the whole world. And then comes in 1624, Clavarius, with 6 volumes of compendium on universal geography. He followed Münster, but his informations were better. Then comes next year, N. Carpenter, whose first universal geography was written in English language. And then comes the real person who started the first real step from cosmography towards making this as a systematic science. The person was Bernard Werenius, with his work Geographia Generali in 1650. So we can say that he gave a foundation of systematic geography based on his studies of geographical, mathematical, physiological, chorological, and all these things. So he gave 2 branches of geography, general and special geography. In general geography, he talked about general laws and hypothesis of wider applicability. While in the special or particular geography, he was describing about the particular places, or what we call today as regional geography. So that was the first time when the foundation of regional geography started. So in-depth study of different places with general geography could pursue its distribution on hypothesis and task of detecting a special pattern of Earth. So that was the first real work of Werenius. And before Werenius, I missed one work, although you can laugh today, but at that time it was very seminal work, like Jean Bodin's Climatic Zonation, where he talked about the northern people who have martial characteristics, and southern people, means people in southern hemisphere having religious characteristics, and the middle zone, the people in the middle zone having civilized life. And that is because of the influence of Mars in the northern influence of Jupiter in the middle and influence of Saturn in the southern. So according to him, the middle people in the middle latitudes were more civilized, are better. So all these things were, as you can see, more or less a descriptive sort of. But when we start from Varanius, the things change. Varanius also worked on regional description of Japan and Siam, and he very in his general geography he had discussed about the celestial, terrestrial, and human factors. Celestial means those that we are talking in astronomical things like the heavenly bodies, planets, stars, and all. Terrestrial factors on the Earth surface and human and their interaction. These things were really seminal at that time. And if we see after 200 years, the concept of chorology by Richtofen. So he actually took the concept of a spatial geography from Varanius. If we go in detail, we know, okay, we will discuss it later on. From here, the different phases of science, which are now concerned basically in the science of geography, started to originate. Like the first one was origin of Earth. All the concepts of the origin of Earth. In 1682, Edmund Halley, he gave the theory of comets. Then William Whiston, who said that the Earth was made from the debris of a comet and that the gravitational pull of a second approaching comet had caused the elliptical orbit of the Earth around the Sun and led to tidal waves caused by gravitational pulls. So the concept of creation of continents and ocean basins, that how the crest of waves they created continent and troughs of waves made ocean basin. Then comes A.G. Werner of Germany, again 1749 to 1817. He also said that the flood that had been caused by cooling of Earth atmosphere led to dissolution of materials from Earth crust. The dissolved materials of the crust were deposited on the surface of the Earth in form of a series of layers so that large parts of the Earth's surface are covered with sedimentary strata. So the concept of crust and how the crust was formed, this thing, these three contributors were there in the origin of Earth. Then the theories related to origin of landforms started. In 1719, John Strachey, he said that the landforms reflected the rock structure lying underneath them. Then in 1777, Simon Pallas, he published geological maps to show that the cores of most mountain ranges are made up of granite. Then in 1786, Louis Gabriel Comte, he mathematically explained how the flowing water of a river can establish equilibrium between velocity and the load of sediment being transported by it. So actually it led to the idea of graded river profile, what we study in the normal cycle of erosion, the start, the youth stage, from the youth stage to the graded this thing, river. That concept originated by that time of 1786. Then comes James Hutton, 1726 to 97, and his famous concept of uniformitarianism, that the processes that shape the Earth's surface indicate a perpetual process of change with no vestige of a beginning and no prospect of an end. Let us understand this concept, that he was the first person who talked about this thing, that see, the present is the key to the past. If we understand the processes, because see, geomorphic processes are two types. One is the outer one and exogenic, that is outside the Earth surface, and the endogenic, that emanates from the core. So both the geomorphic processes, they have been existing ever since the Earth surface. So if we study the processes very easily, we can find out how the structure of different landforms changed from different phases. So that gave the key to different theories, and basically the Davis theory or the Peng theory of the normal cycle of erosion, they were based on this thing. Then comes the scientific classification of plants and animals. Yes, you can see, as I said, that from Copernicus to Newton, the one parallel movement towards development of physical science was going on at that time. Similarly, in the biological science, let us start from this Carlos Linnaeus in 1707 to 78. He was a Swedish who classified biological science based on classes, orders, genera, species, followed by Lamarck, who was a French who found the need of classification based on natural characteristics and biological evolutionary theory. All these things summed up from 18th century till 19th century, when Origin of Species will come by Charles Darwin. So you can see that the parallel work were going in the physics and biology also, as our cosmography was proceeding towards the scientific notion. Then the fourth one was scientific study of man. The first such seminal work towards scientific study of the man was given by, again, a German, J.P. Sussmelch, in 1741, who gave the statistical regularities in population data. So male-female ratio, their balance, then birth and death that can be predicted, extrapolated by the past data. At that time, hardly there were any takers, but almost 100 years after that, see, this is 1741, and this is 1848. 1848, Lambert, he used probability theory and showed how individual they tend to group around averages. So you can say that the earlier work on population geography or demography started from here. And then came the fifth such seminal work on the role of environment in shaping human behavior patterns. So here, as I discussed before, Wernicke's gene bodily, that how he gave climatic zonation, that northern people have martial characteristic, middle people have civilized characteristics, civilized life, and southern have religious. So these are based on the effect of different planets, like for the northern it is Mars, for the middle it is Jupiter, and for the southern it is Saturn. And he says that yes, the middle region people, they are good to rule the world. And in N. Carpenter, in his cosmography, also discussed about this idea of Jean Bodin. Then there was one French scholar, Abbé de Bos. He studied on the weather and their effect on suicidal rates. Like it is high in Paris before onset of winter and just after winter. Similarly, it is in Rome during two hottest months. You can see the high and low suicidal rates. Later on, we will start discuss about this thing in environmental determinism also. Then comes Charles Louis Montesquieu in 1745. And he also supported Jean Bodin concept, that climatic zonation and the way people act or behave is directly linked. Say, like he says, that the warm climate encourages despotism and slavery, while the cold climate encourages democracy and freedom. And he says that if anybody moves from north to south, he will lose his bravery and all. So today these things are laughable, but they were at that time when cosmography was moving towards scientific geography, these small notions were also coming up. Then we move to Count Buffon, a French, who was director of Jardin du Botanical Garden, Paris. He had given the first work resulting from reports of different voices, like Histoire Naturelle, generally et particulier, to search the regularity and to find out the laws governing processes, an inductive approach. Although he believed in a divine creation of art. See, here this teleological approach, if we say, we can relate to the ancient Aristotelian theory, because and it was carried, the divine creation of art was carried from there even till Ritter time. And then he was the first to focus man as an agent of geographical change, and how earth is cooling gradually, how crust is formed, and he believed in climatic determinism. But also he says that man is not a passive agent, rather he has technology and culture to modify the earth. Then comes the first scientific traveler, Edmund Halley, 1756 to 1742. He tried to derive order out of complex data based on mortality rate in 1693. He gave many graphic methodology for showing geographical distribution of physical features of the earth, and then he prepared a maps and discussed how trade winds of Atlantic Ocean, their wind shift, and all they were affecting human activities. Then comes two works of Foster's. Foster, who went with Captain Cook on the voyage of Australia and Pacific Ocean, and in Indian Ocean also, and he wrote a lot about temperature pattern of eastern and western margins of landmass, and how climate of Western Europe and Western North American coast are similar. And majority of his works, they were really helpful to Humboldt. Later on, we will discuss how Humboldt and Ritter, they were the real modern founders of geography in the world. So before them, these were the small works going on, like even in 1742 to 1830, majority of you know the name of Major James Runnels. He was founder of oceanography and the first Surveyor General of India. He prepared in 1779 Atlas of Bengal, and his work was also seminal work towards map making and all this oceanography, and putting this science geography on the scientific table. Then the work of Malthus in 1798, where he and his essays on population and food supply came up. Then we have in 1700 to 1773 Philippe Bouquet, a French who wrote the major, he said that the earth's surface is marked off into a series of major basins bordered by continuous ranges of mountains, forming drainage divides between adjoining basins. You know this concept of continuous mountain ranges and drainage basins that are bordered by these mountain ranges. Those drainage, this concept was completely refuted by the work of Humboldt when he went for his 5 years voyage to South America. I will discuss about it in, later on. So his basin concept was taken by Gartner as a natural reason. Then we have Anton Frederick Bushing, who wrote 6-volume works on Europe and first geographer to calculate population density. Okay. Then we have Conrad Marty Brun. He was born in Denmark and moved to France. His 8-volume universal geography with latest information, where first volume was on history of geography and second on general concepts of origin of earth, map projection, catastrophism, uniformityism, and all these things. And he rejected climatic determinism concept of Dauphin and Montesquieu. Then comes the first or the foremost or the father or the founder of philosophy, Immanuel Kant, and his great work in form of Critique of Pure Reason. So, although he was contemporary of Malte Brun, but he was the flag bearer after Vyrenius, who classified geography into logical and physical. He classified this phenomena of nature into logical and physical classification. In the logical classification, he grouped individual items into separate classes on the basis of morphological similarities and process of origin. While physical classification, he grouped them based on the same place or same time. So what Vyrenius had given, he also carried forward. Like, he gave a series of systematic sciences, each devoted to a particular kind of phenomena, like botany, geology, physics, chemistry, economics, political science, sociology. Similarly, grouping of phenomena in physical classification, he gave historical science based on time, and then a spatial science based on space. His concept of space He said that space is not something objective and real, nor is it a substance or an accident or a relation, but it is subjective and ideal and proceeds from the nature of the mind by an unchanging law as a scheme for coordinating with each other absolutely all things externally sensed. So you can see that it was factual and based on the person of their opinion. And according to him, there was no subject-object dichotomy and time-space dualism. Instead, the space is a structure of human cognition. So, and from here, he started two great contemporary modern founders of geography in the form of Humboldt and Ritter. Humboldt is dead. His date of birth is 1769, and to 1859, and Ritter 1779 to 1859. Ritter was 10 years younger to Humboldt. Both died on the year when the great work of Origin of Species by Charles Darwin came. So both the contemporaries, Humboldt, he moved from. He moved from Germany, going through Orinoco Basin, then mapping there, and moving to Ecuador, Peru, finding a lot of these things, even climbing Chimborazo, then writing the first book on Mexico, moving towards Philadelphia, and returned in 5 years to Germany. And he was the first such great scholar who wanted to develop a universal science. His concept of physique du monde, that means he tried to reduce experiments to general laws to establish harmony among the phenomena. And his work of cosmos was a great work. Even now, that word cosmos is used in the geography fraternity as a very precious work. He was influenced by the work of George Foster, basically his work around this Pacific Ocean and all, and then Ryan Netherland. Cosmos in the first volume gives a general picture of universe. It is a descriptive one. Second one portrays nature by landscape painters and poets through ages. It is a historical and evolutionary. Then astronomy, laws, and celestial bodies in the third volume. Fourth volume of Earth, it was planned to complete fourth volume in two parts as physical geography, but later on it remained like that. The fifth volume is on general description of plant and animal geography and a study of man, and this fifth volume was published in 1862 after his death. Some of the interesting contributions during his voyage can be enlisted, as if in the Orinoco Basin, when he was moving, he gave a first example of river capture at when he wrote about Rio Negro in the Amazon. Then he gave irrefutable proof against Bokke's theory of continuous mountain chain. When he moved to Andes, he wrote about the effect of altitude, temperature, nature of agriculture, and how it affects the human. Then he moved to Klein Chamberejo, also in Ecuador, and gave its altitude as 19,286 feet, although later on it was found that it is 20,561 feet. He gave the fertilizer guano of Peru and its importance in the present arena also. Then the movement of ocean water that along Peru, that is now called as Humboldt Current. Then he also proved Werner's theory wrong. Werner had said that sedimentary, all the rocks are of sedimentary origin. Then he moved to Mexico, where he wrote the first regional geography of Mexico. Then comes Ritter with his teleological approach and the concept of unity in diversity. He was a great addition. He was not against what Humboldt has said, but he was a great addition with his Erdkunde. You know, there are 19 volumes of Erdkunde, and they cover almost everything. And he gave a new scientific geography. And in, with his teleological approach of science, he gave that there are three fundamental facts of geography which have no explanation in science. Now, first one is uniqueness of the Earth in the universe. If you could recall the students of regional geography, the first thing that they learn in regional geography is that a region is a unique. So, uniqueness of the Earth in the universe, then Earth as the home of that unique creature, that is the man. And then fundamental explanation of a host of geographical facts. You can't say that it is completely going to be theoretical or universal science. So that point can be taken from there. Then he was followed by many eminent German geographers, and also about them we will discuss in the dichotomy. So I can say, let me stop the first phase of my lecture, that from cosmography to the modern geography on the platform of scientific science or scientific reform, we stop here, and then we move to the second portion where we have to discuss about dichotomies. So one by one, we will start from general versus particular. Let me give a small formula to my students. Here I am addressing students. Remember this, GDP. GDP means general to particular, and D is deductive. So in the deductive approach, you try to move from general to particular. General to particular, you will say that if I say, for example, this COVID-19, if I want to study about problem of my area, local area, with deductive approach, I will first start studying about the world and then move from the world to the different countries, to the states, to the district, block, and then to my village or my urban area. So at once you will say, what you are doing? But yes, if here the reactive approach is trying to find out how the things are moving from top to bottom, and then go to the another one, the opposite of that, that is particular to general, PIG, that is inductive approach. In inductive approach, you try to, like if you want to solve that problem of COVID, first you try to find out a small zones at the community level. Try to find out if they are in the green zone, orange zone, or red zone, and then take action. Instead of waiting for WHO to take any action. You can do it at local level. So what I say that here you act at the local level, at the micro level, add all these micro to meso and then meso to the macro. So from bottom to top, you have adopted inductive approach. So that way, you move from general to particular and particular to general. Then comes the another dichotomy of physical geography and human geography. Again, if you read the books on thought, you will see that ultimately majority of the geographers, they said that no, you can't demarcate them. But you know that it is very important if you want to enrich your knowledge, it's better to compartmentalize and then study on different platforms. In physical geography, basically lithosphere, hydrosphere, atmosphere and biosphere. These are read in the form of geomorphology, oceanography, climatology and biology. They are very necessary. And you can't, and the study of these physical geography and their phenomena are more scientific than human. Because in human, again, majority of the things, they can't be universalized, like your action, your activity is very tough. In human geography, we basically concentrate on socio-cultural, behavioral, economic, resource-based, population, settlement, and environment-based studies. Nowadays, we have another form in the form of applied geography, where we study regional planning, disaster management, GIS remote sensing, and cartography. Let me tell you, during RITER phase, the tools and techniques of geography or these applied portions started to be studied. What happened with RITER is that he left a long legacy, and those people, they developed these applied portions to the level that today map making is also sometimes people consider it as a another subject, but it is actually the way of making maps. So it is tool and technique of geography. So now, even today, I would say that let's have these two dichotomies of physical and human, and let's have this applied to solve the our problems at the community level or at the national level, sub-national. See, community level solution of all the problems are the best. If you move from there to sub-national level, at regional level, also that is going to solve the problem. But all over the world, making a sub-national plan is not easy. So usually what we do, we plan at community level, we move to the state level and to the national level. And that adds to the global planning. So tools and techniques are important, but they are not the the separate subject matter. We still stick with the basic geography as the science. So let's discuss about that. That is the systematic and regional. If again you could recall from Varenius and Immanuel Kant, how he gave general and a special geography. So what he gave as general geography is systematic, or in the Americans, it is topical. That is based on particular topics like the structure, relief, climate, soil, vegetation. These are all systematically ordered, arranged, and studied. So in the regional, we have formal and functional region. Functional regions like if you find the homogeneity of particular things like a particular culture or a particular phenomena, you can easily demarcate a formal region. And functional based on the activities. So we have a lot of climatic regions, natural regions, aeroclimatic regions, industrial regions, and river basin. This river basin development plan or the urban development plans, these are the functional regions. These are very successful. But sub-national plan based on the formal regionalization are not very successful, not only in India, anywhere in the world, because they encounter the issue of political constraints. Now let's move to another dichotomy of determinism and possibilism that is most discussed in geography. So what I will give, one, two example from the ancient determinist and some example from the modern. What environmental determinism says? Environmental determinism says that environment is superior and we are part of that environment, and what it decides, it provides us everything to survive. Or if I can quote Mahatma Gandhi, that nature has everything for our need but nothing for our greed. That is a very perfect way of determinism. Like, nature provides you with everything you should use, but don't go beyond exploiting or over or abusing that nature. It starts with Hippocrates on his work on airs, waters and places in 420 BC, when he wrote that Europeans are hardworking because of their climate. Their climate is cool, so they are very hardworking. While Asians are lazy because their weather is hot. So almost the same thing was taken up by Aristotle in his book Politics, when he talked that the Europeans are very brave, but they have two demerits. First, they have not very good thought process and not very good technical skills. So what happens that they can remain free as longer as they want, but it is very tough for them to make a political organization and to rule their neighbors. So these two things are challenging for them, actually. And then almost the same thing was said by Strabo about Romans, and how the Italy and their civilization is strong because of their climate. Their site and situation factor and climate is very much conducive to their life. In the middle phases, again, we discussed about Jean Bodin, about his northern people, temperate, those people in temperate climate and those people in southern climate. Then comes the Montesquieu. Again, we have discussed about these two people, so I will skip. Then comes Kirchhoff. In his work, Man and the Earth, he said how the inhabitants of basaltic region are so strong, like basalt, that it is very difficult to govern them. Immanuel Kant, he was really a great philosopher. So here also he talked about all inhabitants of hot land. And those who are in far north, they are very lazy and they are also timid and they do not have that much of threats to rule. While the people in the mountains are good, they have mercy, merry, they are brave, they have freedom lovers. And he also, he was the first person who talked about adaptation, how animal and human being who migrate to different places, they change according to their environment. Then comes Humboldt by his Cosmos, where he talked about determinism, the effect of climate on the people, by like how Iranian and Pontian people, they are so brave thanks to their Mediterranean climate and their fooding. Then Ritter in his Old Kunde, he discussed about the maritime power of the Dutches, and that directly links to the climate of the ocean. Then came the concept of Haeckel on ecology. Ecology originated from oikos, that means the habitat. So the people of the UK, their murder, their suicide, their marriages, their breakups, divorces, they were all related to the tides or the different seasons. So if you could recall what I started with Abbé Bosse of France, how he wrote about the societal rate of weather, and here the same thing written by Haeckel in Britain. So these are all deterministic, how the weather decides your life. Then Buckle, in his History of Civilization in England, he very clearly wrote about the fertility of soil and the level of civilization. If the fertility of soil is good, the civilization is also very good. Then came another person, was Desmoulins, who took the concept of Laplace, who says that work place for, how the work of the people and their life is related to the place they live. And he also discussed about the effect of population distribution and density on nature, and how the people of steppes or the people of mountainous climate, their life and the animals, even the animals, their survival is directly linked to the place where they live. Then comes Frederick Ratzel. I can say the proponent or the founder or the father of human geography. He had written two books, one Anthropogeography in 1882 and another in 1891. Then he wrote the book on history of mankind. He wrote book on political geography. And he says that man is product of his environment, molded by physical forces that surround him, and succeeds only in so far as he makes current adjustment to their demands. His concept of social determinism was cast by none other than Hitler. He says that if a state wants to survive, it has to capture the boundary of the neighboring states. So that is the social determinism. One society can dominate or survive only when it involves the neighboring societies. So maybe it was misinterpreted, but it was taken by Hitler. No. And Frederick Ratzel, at the end of his life, he also gave antithesis to this. But here we are discussing about determinism, so we stick with that, that man is product of his environment. And he had a very talented student in the form of Miss E.C. Semple, an American who went back to America. And in 1911, she wrote Influences of Geographic Environment, where she wrote that in human geography, we study the changing relationship between unresting man and unstable earth. She gave how the environment decides or determines the way of life of the unresting man. Number one, direct physical effect through the climate or the altitude. Number two, psychical, like their culture, their art, their religion. Number three, through socioeconomic, that is resources and the means of livelihood. And the fourth one is movement of people, like if the through mountains, through rivers, through gaps, gorges. So these are determined by nature. We only follow. Then comes another great determinist of America. I would say greatest. He was Ellsworth Huntington. His works were Principles of Human Geography, Pulse of Asia, Civilization and Climate. Here he says that man's character and occupation are decided by geographical condition in which they live. He was the man who said that East is East, West is West. Means we in the West, we are the best because our environment is like that. So great determinist, and I can say great racist also. So here the dichotomy or determinism, nobody refutes that the nature is the most dominating factor for all of us. But let me quote another great scientist on political science, Hegel. He says that don't talk to me about environmental determinism. Where the Greeks once lived, the Turks live now, and that settles the matter. What is more going to be discussed on the issue? This is the greatest explanation of that. Then let me quote another one from George Statham, who says that though environment undoubtedly influences man, man in turn changes his environment, and interaction is no intricate than it is difficult to know when one influence ceases and the other begins. So from here, we move to the another dualism that is called possibilism. Possibilism says that man with his ability, his skill, that we have mind, we have thinking process, we have hands, legs. So by this, by our thought, by our action, we can do anything. We can do anything to change this world. We can do anything to live. We can change, we can challenge any odds, and we can survive. Like you can see that if you see the European people, how although the weather is not conducive, but they use greenhouse to for their vegetables, or they warm their house earlier by coal, and nowadays with the natural gas, and still they survive at minus 10 degree, minus 20 degree. If we see the people in Canada, or if we see people around Siberia, and so how they manage to survive. They are living in more temperate and tundra and those type of weather and climate, and still they survive. Here I must quote from Fabre in 1925, his book Geographical Introduction to History. He says that the true and only geographical problem is that of utilization of possibilities. There are no necessities, but everywhere possibilities. And man, as a master of these possibilities, is the judge of their use. So it is very famous saying, there are no necessities, everywhere possibilities. So they can do anything by their thinking process, by their actions. The greatest philosopher here was Wardell de la Blache, whose work Principal de Geographie Humaine in 1921 established his all concepts, and his concept of gender divide, the way of living or the culture, which provides a basic factor in determining which of the many possibilities in the natural environment shall be selected by a given community. No, he even gave the concept of space, a characteristic segment of Earth's surface where mutually interaction of man and action takes place. He gave the role of history in its development of the space. Then came Jean Bruns, student of Wardell de la Blache of Paul Blas. He was also his son-in-law. So his famous book of 1920, Geographie Humaine, Isaïe de la Classification Positive, which was later on translated by Isaiah Bauman, where he talks about these principles of activity and interaction, and how our human activities are grouped into three, that we started from unproductive occupation of land to the conquest of land, plants, animals, and now we are moved to the destructive phase of the resources and all. And everything around us is undergoing transformation. Everything is increasing or diminishing, and nothing is really motionless. So these were all the concepts of Jean Bruns. Kirchhoff again talks about that man is not an automation without a will of his own. Isaiah Bauman, as I said, that he translated work of Jean Bruns, and he also wrote the book The Pioneer Thing. Isaiah Bauman was an American who was given a big task by the government for their large scale mapping also. He says that no nation ever declined because it exhausted the possibilities of the land. So he was a great possibilist. Then comes his contemporary Karl Sauer with his concept of cultural landscape. He says that nature is silent before technology and scientific man, and what we study today is not the natural landscape. Rather, we human, by our action, we have turned it into the cultural landscape. So what is the demerit of this possibilism? That it only talks half of the truth. So then we move to neo-determinism. Neo-determinism, given by Griffith Taylor in 1951, says in his book Geography in the 20th Century that man is like a traffic controller in a city. So what you can do, that if you need the resource for your development, you use it, but only it sustainable, that don't use it beyond that limit and then stop. So this is called a stop and go determinism. Go, stop, go. You use, don't misuse, don't abuse, and then move to other things. So these are the important parts of dualism. Then comes the last but not the least. It was the difference. It was the difference of nomothetic and ideographic. See, actually, it has nothing to do with geography. It was given by a German scholar, I will say that in order to give a post-Kantian, and after Immanuel Kant, he gave something to be taken for both the sciences, natural sciences and social sciences. That see, if we want to generalize for natural science, and if we want to derive laws and go for the objectivity, we need to adopt nomothetic approach. And in the ideographic, we have to specialize, to specify social sciences, and to try to find out the the descriptions of the uniqueness of anything. It can be symbolic also, like the same symbol can be used for different purposes at different places. So it is not very much scientific, but yes, it is also an approach in the modern things. I think by this I conclude, and thank you very much. Conclude now. Is Dr. Uday there?
Hello,
sir, can you hear me? Hello. Sir, on behalf of Bhattur College, Daton, and also on behalf of the Geography Department, Bhattur College, Daton, thank you once again. Really, it was a valuable lecture, and I think this lecture enrich us and also our student too. Hopefully, in future, if you have enough time, we can invite you again. On such type of platform, and your lecture was nice, I think, because you start with a cosmography, the very beginning of geography, and it's finished with a scientific and applied geography. So thank you very much, and I request you to close this session. Thank you very much, sir.